service this morning, Father, we thank you for the songs that we sing, praise to you. Central Alaska, number 41. In number 41, we'll sing all four of them.
Thank you. look beyond my fault. Let's try that this morning. This morning that you'll help us, Father, as we come before you and as we lift our voice to you, as we open our heart to you, as we praise you and worship you for who you are and what you've done for us, Lord, that you'll just take that for what it is, Lord, that we love you and we thank you so much for being our God. Father, I pray that if somebody here doesn't know you as Savior, that, Lord, they'll not put that decision off any longer. Lord, that they'll come to you and, Lord, they'll become one of your children today. Lord, I pray you'll help Brother Paul as he preaches. Just give him the word that you want us to have today. Lord, I pray you help us to receive it. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would just fill this place. We love you, Lord. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. This morning, we have a youngster, first grade, and first grade young and be dismissed this morning.
Yes.
You want to listen to the word sometimes. I was watching on the screen how marvelous the grace that caught my falling soul. Amen. That's good, Lord.
Amen.
That's good. Well, if you've never been caught by the Holy Spirit and drawn to Jesus, you've never been saved. Because that's the way people get saved. You don't come on your own. You come because the Holy Spirit is leading you and drawing you. Some of you may have felt that. It is a feeling. It is an emotion because it's real. Old-timers called it coming under conviction for our sins. And you can't get saved unless you realize you're a sinner. And when you realize you're a sinner, then you come to that conclusion, I can't save myself.
That's right.
You're not going to make it on your own. And then you realize that the Bible says it's so easy. All you have to do is call on the name of Jesus, and He'll save you. If you've never done that, that's what we want for you today. It's simple. It's easy. And you might think, well, I can't do that in front of a crowd of people. Listen, all of us here have been saved. We've done that. We've come before a crowd of God's people in a church setting and said, Jesus saved my soul. Listen, when you do that, it makes it very, very real. Now, I needed to say all that because my sermon had nothing to do with that. I really struggled with what I was going to preach, and the Lord, well, tell you the truth, I put two sermons together. Go ahead and gnash your teeth, all right? You say, this is going to be long. Well, I cut her down to 3 pages of notes, all right? We're going to look at 2 passages of Scripture, thus the 2 sermons. They're both on the same subject, so I kind of combined some of this. And I want to preach today entitled, How to Find Strength in the Lord. That's not what it says on the screen because I gave Joel the wrong title. The title from the Scripture says that David strengthened himself in the Lord. So anyway, that's what I'm going to focus on in the message today. I want to give you some bad news if you're not aware of it. And if you've been around here very long, you're aware of this, all right? If you're a child of God, you're going to have trouble in this world. There's no way around that. In fact, that's what the Bible teaches. In this world, you'll have trouble. And Jesus promised that to his closest followers as he was telling them that he was going to go away from them, and he had to go away. And he even laid out what was going to happen for them step by step down the road. He even told some of them how they were going to die. They're going to be martyred because they were followers of his. Now, if you listen to some TV preachers, they'll tell you it's not that way, that God wants you to be happy. God wants you to always have all good things and great things. God wants you to be rich. That's not always true.
Amen.
Not always true. Listen, in the world, you'll have trouble. And with reference to that, and I've said this 1,000 times in sermons, but I have to say it again. Y'all probably know what I'm going to say. How many of you know what I'm going to say? There are 3 groups of people when it comes to people in trouble. There are those that are in trouble, they're going through it right now. There are those that have just come out of trouble. And there are those that are getting ready to go back into another episode of trouble. You know why? Because in Job we learn so much. I've been listening to the book of Job again this year, recently. And Job lays it out so plainly that in this world you're going to have problems.
Right.
We all have problems. Good point, not on the screen, but listen. The world does not offer us much hope when we're going through difficult times. But God does.
Yes.
I said, but God does.
Amen.
So today I want to look at a story that happened in David's life. Well, I'm going to tell you, it's the story I think that we'll tell you the story, and then we're going to go to a psalm. We're going to go to Psalm 31 later on. But I believe that Psalm 31 was written as a result of the incident that we're going to read about in King David's life. David had already been anointed king. And he had become king of Judah, but not all of Israel, okay? Excuse me. Saul hated David. He despised him. In fact, listen to this. I don't know how to explain it. I don't understand it. But the Bible says an evil spirit from God came upon Saul. Does anybody understand that? I don't understand it, but I believe it because that's what the Bible says.
Amen.
Y'all going to have to help me today or I'll be up here a long time. Okay? I believe it because that's what the Bible says. So something was going on in David's life. And it was probably Saul's threatful revenge at two different occasions in a room crowded with people. Saul hurled a spear at David, and David was quick enough to move out of the way. He would have pinned him to the wall with that spear because he hated him so much. Some people think that what we're going to read about in Psalm 31 was written as a result of Saul's hatred and attempting to assassinate and to kill him. David went through a lot of major problems in his life with his family and with his children. He had a son who raped his half-sister. The full brother of that sister murdered his half-brother. David had another son named Absalom. Absalom was a ladies' man. He had long, flowing hair, and he had it cut. He called in a crew of people to watch and witness all this. It was a big production, and they weighed his hair every year to see how much it would weigh. And by the way, that long hair is what got him in trouble. My dad told me that. I'm a product of the 60s and 70s, and I wanted my hair to be long. And he said, don't grow your hair long. Because Absalom rode his mule under a tree, and his hair got caught in the fork of the tree, and he was hung there. And Joab came around and ran three darts to his heart and killed him. So better be careful about that, okay? If you're riding a mule anyway. That's not a Kawasaki mule, okay? Anyway, Absalom, he ascended to the throne, and David was just going to give in to him until God took over. And some think Psalm 31 was written. We're reading, all right, as a result of that. I think, and I believe, and a lot of other people that I read after, this is what I'm going to read, and I think Psalm 31 is a result of what happened in 1 Samuel chapter 30. Glad you gave me a little extra time, Brother Clark, all right? The backdrop of 1 Samuel 30, let me tell you a little bit. David and his 600 mighty men who were warring with him, they had gone down to live with the Philistines because Saul would never find them there. And David had become so attached to the king of the Philistines and the head of the army that he made David his right-hand man. Well, the Philistines were about to go to war with Israel. And they didn't trust David enough to take him to battle with them. So they sent David back to his city. He had overtaken the city and it became known as David's City. It was a town called Ziklag. And when David's men had come to the Philistines to battle with them, they left all of their belongings, they left their wives and their children back in Ziklag. And while they were gone warring, the Amalekites came in and they burned the city of Ziklag. And they took all of their wives and their children and kidnapped them and took them back to their town. When David and his men went back and discovered what had happened, things went south quickly. The men whose wives and children, David's followers, David's warriors, the ones in David's army, they turned on David. In fact, they threatened to stone him to death. And the Bible says that David strengthened himself in the Lord. Say that with me. David strengthened himself in the Lord. Now I'm going to ask you a question. I want you to be honest, and I'm going to be honest with you too, all right? How many of you really know how to strengthen yourself in the Lord? If you do, raise your hand. There's a few. You need to know how to strengthen yourself in the Lord when you're going through difficult times. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
I believe that David underwent an intentional, specific, spiritual process, and I think Psalm 31 was written as a result of that. All right? I'm not going to read everything in 1 Samuel chapter 30, whatever it is, but it's going to be on the screen. All right? Joel, just bring it up, and let me kind of break it down for you. All right? The first three or four verses, but I want to focus first on verses 4 or 5 and the first part of verse number 6. When all of this came to pass, and David saw what had happened, and the men had turned on him, they were threatened to stone him, the first thing David did is he went before God, listen, and he exhibited great remorse. Joel, you can't show all this on the screen and show those points on the slides, okay? Go ahead and go to the points on the slides and I'll read the verses, all right? Listen to verses 4. And David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives were taken captives, Ahinoam, the Jezreelites, and Abigail, the wife of Nabal. And David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved. They were in a bad way. They were at a point that they had never been at before. They'd been through battles. They'd had losses before. And now, almost everything dear to them was gone. And David exhibited great regret and remorse. That's the first thing he did. I don't know if he thought he'd made a mistake. I don't know if he thought he'd messed up. But he knew that he was in trouble with those closest to him. Last part of verse number 6, all right? It says in King James, but David encouraged himself in the Lord. The NIV and the ESV say David strengthened himself in the Lord. So how did he do that? Well, the first thing he did was he redirected his focus. In times of great distress, listen to this, you need to hear this. In times of great distress, when things are going south in your life, you need to learn to take your eyes off of your circumstances and look to God. Listen, there are three things that will rob you of your joy in life. People, somebody say amen.
Amen.
People, circumstances, and sometimes your finances. You can't do anything about your circumstances. Some of the time, you can, but for the most part, you can't. And so I can rise above them. Listen, circumstances are such a part of life, they're like a mattress we just lay on. Something we have to live with. Can't change sometimes, all right? People, you sure can't change people, amen?
Amen.
Can't do anything about them. You can try all you want to. I was like it, raising children. I've been through it. Helped raise six, okay? And for the most part, they turned out pretty good in spite of me and in spite of Becky. I'm glad I threw that in. Where is she? Where are you hiding? I see you. I'm not sitting in a very rough crowd. That's why I'm here. Sometimes our children break our hearts. And David had been through that. He knew how to encourage himself in the Lord, but he took his eyes off of his problem. He faced up to the decisions that had brought him trouble. And David made a choice. Change directions. Yesterday, Becky and I probably had one of the worst days we've had in a long time. literally. Now listen, if you never had one of these days, don't laugh. Because when you do, it ain't funny. Have you ever had a day where everything you touched broke? Huh? Have you? Somebody raise your hand. All right, those of you who've never been exposed to that, blessings, tidings, and I hope it happens to you soon. Because you won't laugh, okay? You won't laugh. Anyway, if you keep focusing on it, and I was afraid to touch anything else. I said, well, if I do that, I'll tear that one up too, all right? We got up of a morning, there were three big limbs down in the tree right by our garage in the front yard. And there's one stuck up there, and it's about that big around, 30 feet up. Well, number one, I'm not going up there. Number two, my grandson's not going up there. Number three, I'm going to have to call somebody because it's just stuck right in a V. And if it falls, it's going to hit my house. And I don't want it to hit the house because insurance probably wouldn't cover it then because it's been hanging up there for some time. So anyway, I'm thinking, how can I do this? And I thought, you know, if I could just get up and get the chain on that and tie it to the bumper of my truck, even long enough set of chain, and back up and get around, I could jerk it out of there fast enough. And I said, nope, something's going to go wrong. Problems are a part of life. I like one translation where it says David encouraged himself in the Lord. It said David repaired himself. Let's move to verses 7 and 8. So David said to Abiathar the priest, he looked at the priest that was there, Elimelech's son, and he said, bring the ephod. The ephod was a tool that the priest used to contact God and find out God's explicit will. Okay? God gave him direction through the ephod. And I like verse 8. And David inquired of the Lord and said, what do I do? Look at it. In times of great distress, I mean when you're beyond stress and you don't know what to do, inquire of the Lord. Request God's help. It'll make a difference, I promise you, all right? For most of us, requesting God's help is our last resort. It ought to be our first thought. But we try, and we scheme, and we work on it, and we talk to it. Just call on God. Just call on God. He responded obediently to God's directions. God said, yes, you go down here, you'll overtake them. And that's exactly what happened. Listen, get this point. Faithfulness is easy in good times. But it's difficult in hard times. Some of y'all don't know that because you haven't been through it yet. But it's difficult. I want to say this, and I don't like to single out people, but we've got some ladies in our church who most recently became widows. One of the most difficult things to do is to come back to church without your spouse. When your spouse is always sitting beside you, that's the way it's been most of your life. That's hard to do. And I know it's not easy for them, but you know how they did it? They made up their minds that's what they were going to do. They made up their minds. Finally, David recovered all of his losses. We sometimes think that recovery means recouping everything exactly as it was before that we had lost. For David and his mighty men, that was true. But listen, sometimes in our losses, we don't recoup that back exactly as it was. But sometimes, God gives us back more than we lost. And sometimes, God gives back better. So with that backdrop in mind, that's still in our mind. We'll get to the sermon and then it's the short part, all right? David, drained, exhausted, happy that he'd regained all, his men weren't threatened to stone him anymore. Turn over to Psalm 31. It's easy to find. I'm going to read this. So go ahead and put those 4 points up the next screen about Psalm 31 reflections. And I'll read it if you don't have a Bible. All right? I want you to look for these as we go through it. All right? I'll say, life is not on this earth. People will fail you. God is never far away. And worship should always be our response. We know it's a Psalm of David. Looking back on everything that just happened in his life, think about it. In thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be ashamed. Imagine how ashamed he felt because they left their wife following David's direction and leadership, and now he's ashamed. Deliver me in thy righteousness. Bow down your ear to me. Deliver me speedily. Be my strong rock. For a house of defense to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress. Therefore, for thy name's sake, lead me and guide me. Pull me out of the net that they have laid privately for me. For you are my strength. If you look at all those things that had happened in his life, David is reflecting back that all the things that happened, life is not always fair. Life is not always fair. Let's keep reading, all right? Into thy hand I commit my spirit, for thou hast redeemed me. By the way, that verse was quoted twice in the New Testament. Does anybody know who quoted them? Jesus on the cross and Stephen when he was stoned. All right. Into thy hand I commit my spirit. Thou hast redeemed me, O Lord. I have hated them. That's a strong word, isn't it? This King David, a man after God's own heart. I have hated them that regard lying vanities, but I trust in the Lord. I will be glad and rejoice in thy mercy, for thou hast considered my trouble. Thou hast known my soul in adversities. And thou hast not shut me up into the hand of the enemy. Thou hast set my feet in a large room. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eyes consumed with grief, yet my soul in my belly, for my life is spent with grief, and my years with sighing. My strength falleth because of my iniquity, and my bones are consumed. I am a reproach among all my enemies, but especially among my neighbors, and a fear among my acquaintance. They that did see me, fled from me. I am forgotten as a dead man out of mind. I am like a broken vessel. For I have heard the splendor of many. Fear was on every side. While they took counsel together against me, they devised to take away my life. But I trusted in the Lord. I said, Thou art my God. My times are in thy hands. Deliver me from the hand of mine enemy and from them that persecute me. Make my face to shine upon thy servant. Save me for thy mercy's sake. Let me not be ashamed, O Lord, for I have called upon thee. Let the wicked be ashamed and let them be silent in the grave. Let me finish reading. Let the lying lips be put to silence, which speak grievous things proudly and contemptuously against the righteous. Oh, how great is thy goodness, which thou hast laid up for them that fear thee, which thou hast wrought for them that trust in thee before the Son of Man. Just drop down and read the last two verses. Oh, love the Lord, all ye his saints, for the Lord preserves the faithful, plentifully rewarded for the proud people. Be a good church, good church. And he shall strengthen your heart and do your holy will. Life ain't always there. You know it. People will fail. You don't know what you will discover. God ain't as far away as you feel like he is. And you're coming to him. And worship should be our response. I don't know. Is there another slide, Joel? All right, put it up. Don't look at this little spot as well. Some life-changing moments. The day my spouse lived. That'll change you forever. Something along that. The day my parents divorced. I don't care how old children are when their parents divorce. Deep down, they think they need something. And Mark's dead for a long time. The day my loved one died. Most everyone sitting under the sound of my voice, whether present or on Facebook Live, you've experienced some kind of loss in your life. You know what you have. You do it. It changes you forever. Another life-changing moment is when the doctor says, I'm sorry, whatever. Some of you know about that. For some, the life-changing moment was the day you lost your job. You'd been with that company forever, and you've been a good employee, but circumstantially, they didn't want to keep you on anymore, and so they either demoted you or said, you don't have the job anymore. That is a life-changing moment. For many of you, a life-changing moment was the day your friends turned their back on you. And I'm going to ask you today, if you're going through one of those moments, one of those circumstances, something similar, what are you going to do? You're going to have to go back and do what they did. You're going to have to exhibit great reward. You're going to have to call on the name of the Lord. You're going to have to go through that process. Joel, can you go back to that one slide and put it on the screen? I want to put it up there. I want you to see it. I'll go through it with you before I close the slide. He exhibited great regret. He redirected his focus to God. He asked for God's help. When God told him what to do, he responded immediately. He recovered his losses. He reflected on God's power. And then he wrote a song. By your hand. Now, I don't know what you're going through, but you're going to have to make up your mind today what you want to do about it. You can either take it to God. If you find fault, you create your circumstances. Sometimes we do. You've got to think that. You've got to take your eyes and focus off of that and look at how to resolve the issue. Put your eyes back on God. I don't expect a great response at the altar today. It should be. Those of us who need to hear this story. But I want you to respond to God as He needs you. If you're not saved, you get saved just by that. You exhibit great regret over your sins. You call on God. You'll save. Heavenly Father, speak to us now by your Holy Spirit. Apply the word. We know it'll accomplish whatever you set out. In Jesus' name. Amen. While we stand together and sing.
Thank you.
What'd you do, Scott?
Stole her cookies.
Stole her cookies?